Hi, good afternoon, everybody. And it's a pleasure to have all of you here who have shown interest in IPR. And in the morning today, when the session was started, it was stated that they do not encourage a lot of lawyers here unless they are the sponsors. But I must say that GCs and the legal team and the lawyers who are actually practicing, they are in a sacrosanct relationship. It's like husband and wife, you have to work together. You can't live in a closed space, and you can't just shut your eyes to each other. So my endeavor in this session was and is going to be just to share my day-to-day experience and to share what all recent developments have taken place in the field of intellectual property rights. As we see IPR right now, it's no longer only just a trademark issue. It has grown to a larger respect. Now your data protection is covered under it. We have arbitrations in IPR, and we have regulatory problems which are intertwined with intellectual property rights. So it's a little complex now. That's why there is a lot of litigation. And litigation is also not very simple. It's no longer only about injunctions, because we are really moving ahead with very speedy trials. So in IPR, you need experts. And these are the day-to-day challenges and how the courts look at it and what are the practical difficulties which you might face if you are into a litigation. That is the area which I would like to cover. And if there's any question, you are free to ask then and there. I would like it to be more interactive than just giving a lecture here. So a little bit about my firm. My firm was started in the year 1997 by one Mr. Singh and another Mrs. Singh. One Mr. Singh was the additional solicitor general. He just stepped down, and he's practicing as a senior advocate. And Mrs. Singh, I'm sure you would know Mrs. Pratibha Singh. She is the sitting High Court judge now. They stepped down long back, around in 2012, and handed over the baton to us, include four partners, including me. I hope I'm doing a fairly good job. So the recent development which I would like to take you through is about the case laws in the field of trademark, patents, designs, and copyright law, intermediary liabilities and the IP, which is a big thing, talk of the town, damages in IP suit, which is always the aim, because the management is always after the legal team. Where are the damages? Where is the cost? I've spent so much, what have I got? So that's something to answer. GDPR sounds like a ghost, so we would test it, how it is going to be there in India. IP licensing and related issues, because licensing, it's IPR is basically a marketing donut, right? So IPR long back was looked at like an investment. Now it is, you can reap the benefit out of it through licensing. I'll just tell you some to do's and not to do's. And recent development in drug regulatory regime. Is there somebody from the drug industry here? No? Okay. But it does have a little impact on other industries as well, because as we have seen, as there was a regulatory regime in telecom, and there was price regulation, it seeped down to your agrochemicals, your biotechnology, then again drug pricing is the another thing. So we see the regulation of the pricing everywhere. Then amendments to patents rules and trademarks rules, which are very recent, and how are they going to impact and or help you out? We all know that in 2016, a very beautiful paper came, and everybody was talking about it, which was National IPR Policy. A few of the intellectuals were part of it, and the government tried to give an IPR policy, a guidance, a vision to the nation that where the IPR of the nation should head. So in the IPR policies, there were few targets which were to be achieved. I'll just list them out. By the end of the session, we'll see whether we have reached there or we are lagging behind. So awareness, IP awareness was the first target. Then generation of IP, basically how much IP can we generate. With the Make in India campaign of our Prime Minister being launched in that very year, this was one of the Make in India logo. Everybody would have seen. It's the lion with a lot of machinery into it. The target was to encourage innovation. Legal and legislative framework, how it is aiding to it. Administration and management of IP, which is your prosecution. Commercialization of IP, which is again your licensing, making money out of it, which is the ultimate aim. And enforcement and adjudication, stopping others, having a monopoly. And human capital development, which is like involving more and more human into it, even at the level of the school. That was the particular aim. Now, I'll start with recent development trademarks. I'll go trademarks, copyright, and patents. I'll go one by one. I'll do case studies, actual case studies. We know trademarks is very easy. It's like if there's a trademark and somebody has copied your trademark, you can sue them. You have civil remedies, you have criminal remedies. But trademark has expanded the entire law of disparagement comes, it takes its roots from Trademark Act. I think most of us don't know this. We always considered it as a tort, but there is a specific provision. It comes under Section 29 of the Trademarks Act, which is infringement. So there was a very important, popular case of Horlicks versus Heinz, and the advertisement of Complan said that one cup of Complan has the same amount of protein as to two cups of Horlicks. So now, law of disparagement is very clear. You can talk about others' product, you can show others' product, you can compare others' product, but you can't say the others' product is bad. So, not to use a bad word, the famous song, you know, gaal nahi kadna, matlab gaali nahi dena, that's the law of disparagement. So here, it was contested, and they were said that when you are saying that yours one cup has two cups of Horlicks, basically you are saying my strength of protein in my product is low, and so you are demeaning my product, so it's disparaging. But truth is the defense in disparagement. That's the law. They could show that actually there was scientific data, there were testing done, there was proof to show that actually the protein content was more in Complan. So the statement of Heinz was found to be truth. So as I said, truth is the defense. So it wasn't found to be disparaging. Then the very popular ad of our star Mr. Anil Kapoor on namak, ki ye to safed namak hai, aur ye bleach hota hai, ye factory mein banta hai, aur hamara namak is pure and all that. Here, the contrary view was taken. Here, they said that the minute distinction which you are making, that this is white. And also, whom you are targeting. You are targeting Tata. Namak, the white namak, the iodine namak is, the Tata's namak is a symbol of white namak and a pure namak and iodine namak. And when you say yours is just a rock salt and which is not bleached, it's a very minor difference. It doesn't actually impact a lot of, it doesn't give a very bad nature to that Tata's namak if it is bleached. So the court said that it is disparaging in a way. You discontinue the ad. There were also some findings in the matter that, you know, a very popular star is saying about all these things and they should be very careful about all these. So that's the Delhi High Court judgment. That's about trademarks, recent developments in disparagement law. Design law, everybody knows design. Design is basically your shape and configuration of a product, how you look at it. It's the visual impact. It should not have a functionality attached to it. You can get it registered under Designs Act. There was a very popular judgment of three judges of Delhi High Court called Mohan Lal and Sona Paints. It laid down a law, a very different, I won't say weird, different kind of law. It said that you can't combine the cause of actions. If I have a design registration, for instance, of my pen, and even if I have like a trademark registration of that particular shape of the pen, and if I'm been using it since many years, and you know, like the shape of that particular pen has become a symbol of that pen, you know, you can recognize that pen with that particular symbol, you can't club that passing off action which is on your goodwill with your design registration, because design registration is coming from Designs Act and passing off action is coming from your user, your goodwill, common law. So there you can't combine two cause of actions, which was actually contrary to your order to rule 2 CPC, which says whenever you file a suit, all the cause of actions have to be together. You can't pick and choose. So we followed that law for a bit. I remember I did a very unique case of Good Earth, where they had made many cushion designs and motifs were there. I did have design registration, but I could not sue on design registration. I chose to sue on passing off. I got protected, but you know, in a way, I, as a lawyer, felt that my design registration was a waste. I could have used it to convince the court in a better manner. But thereafter, this issue again came before our learned single judge, honorable, late Mr. Valmiki Mehta, who's no more, unfortunately. But he referred this matter. He found that there's some practical difficulty in this matter. So he referred it to a larger bench of 5 judges. Now, this 5 judges' benches came up with a distinction. They overruled that Mohanlal judgment and then said that you can combine these cause of actions. It makes sense to combine. Like, I can also file a design registration suit. I can file a passing off suit, club together, file them together. How does it make a difference, you know? It's better to combine it in one cause of action. So, which is sensible, that's my belief. Then, in patent law, the very recent judgment, which was talk of the town, was Monsanto judgment. It's a very important judgment because it impacted the entire biotech industry. The impact was on everything. Section 3J is a very special section in our Patents Act, which says the innovations which involve parts of plants, parts of animals, are something which are not to be patented. So this Monsanto technology on cotton seeds was a gene which used to make that very cotton plant resistant to some bollworms. So they said once you are inserting that gene into that sequence, it forms part of the plant. So once it forms part of the plant, it is not patentable. So the patent was revoked in this matter. Now, if you think about the implication and the repercussions of this ruling, it in a way killed the entire biotechnology. What are your vaccines? Your vaccines are basically your, you know, antibodies and antigens. That's the way they work. There are dead bacteria which are injected into your body so that antibodies are formed, and then the resistance is built. And so it had a very great impact. So it went to Supreme Court. This is a Supreme Court judgment where the invalidity was overruled. And the matter was remanded back. And there was also a very important facet here. The patent was rejected only on the interim stage. There was no trial. So the finding of the Supreme Court was that you can't revoke a patent when there is no trial, even if the parties had consented. There was a consent of the parties here that, you know, if you decide the issue on 3J, I think nothing survives. But the court said no trial is important in these matters. It's a technical matter. You should have expert evidences. Go back, finish the trial, and then we'll see. Then it's a very important case of Pharmacosmos. It happened just day before yesterday. I was in the court and I was representing the defendant in one of the matter. There's a very important judgment of Ellen Wobbin versus Enercon of Supreme Court. It lays down the ratio that when a patent is being challenged before your IPB or your patent office, when there is a suit against you, patent office gives me a right to file a counterclaim before the court itself. But you can't maintain your post-grant also, your revocation under IPAB also, or your counterclaim also. There can't be like 3 attacks on one patent. You will have to choose. If there is an infringement action, you already have a revocation before IPAB or patent office, okay, simply withdraw it, bring it to the court. Or keep it there. So they gave the liberty to the defendant, But they said, but you will have to choose. Because there can't be contrary views, right? That's the rationale of our entire CBC and Section 10 of CBC. So there was a very interesting line in this judgment, which we just picked up. One of the defendants picked up. It said that when there is a post grant pending before the patent office, and it's pending, the rights in the patent have not been crystallized. Since the rights have not been crystallized, there's a line saying it is impossible to file a suit for infringement of patent. So now the judge, the defendant said that there is a pending post grant before the patent office. They could not have sued me. Now that post grant is by some third party. Now look at the mischief it can cause. I can set up five parties to file post grants against any patents. The patentee will not be able to file any suit against me. If we go by this logic, the mischief is like quite great. But the judge was like, since it's a Supreme Court judgment and the word used is impossible, it didn't say that it is difficult. So let's remand it back to Supreme Court and seek a clarity. But I would give it to the counsel of the plaintiff. I think he did a clever thing. He simply said that, you know, there's a statement made by the defendant that he'll use only this dimer value. If he uses this dimer value, he's outside my patent. So just make it part of decree and I'll be happy with that. Because he didn't want this to be taken up to the Supreme Court. Imagine if this would have gone. I think in few days we would not have seen any patent litigation. Nobody could have filed a suit because saying that, you know, this issue is pending before Supreme Court. So at times it is very wise to take these kind of decisions. Maybe that particular suit got disposed of that very particular day. Maybe one party didn't win, you know, didn't get what they wanted. But for the benefit of the law, you know, if you look at the larger picture, because you can always, even if you are on the defendant side, you can be on the plaintiff's side maybe tomorrow. Right? So since we are moving on the way of innovation, we should always not think us as defenders of the MNC's patents. One day we will be reaching there and we will be the patentees. Then Biogen case is on the approach of the courts. There was an action. It was a drug. It was being used for psoriasis and other diseases. But the patent was taken saying that, you know, it is being used, this particular combination is being used for autoimmune diseases, but this can also be used for multiple sclerosis. Now in India, for your information, new use of a known substance is not allowed. It is like Europe. In Europe, like if a medicine is being used for epilepsy, if you want to use it for instance, stomachache, that is not allowed, you know. You can't get another patent for it. So similar is the situation in India. Maybe in US you can. So there is a statutory distinction, you know, legislature has taken that distinction. So this is the kind of law there in India also, but has not been tested yet. So this was the case where this defense was raised, and this is still pending, and this has to be watched very carefully because the law would be laid down in this matter very soon. But the defendant was allowed to manufacture whatever stocks they had because the patent was just expiring in October 2019. So they said, you manufacture what you want to, but this issue is something which has to be decided. So that's something which is recent. Then Novartis versus Natco. This is important on how the courts are looking at appointment of experts. Courts have been bombarded with patent cases in recent time, and our poor judges, they are actually facing a lot of difficulties, patent cases and all these, even copyright cases where there's a lot of involvement of your technology and source code, they find it very difficult to understand. You know, there's a poor man sitting there, he's not a know-all kind of a person. And they also have a fear that, you know, the councils are telling me something. What if on factual basis it is wrong? Or scientifically it is wrong. I can go wrong. And, you know, that constant fear is there. So there is a provision under Patents Act of appointment of experts. So the court took a stand on that and used that provision. And at the interim stage itself, he said, I will not proceed further. That was the first day of the listing. These are the issues where I need help of scientific people. There could be contrary review, but there would be at least something where scientists agree. So let them file a report, then we'll see. So it is a positive step in the field of IP. There's another positive step in the field of IP when I talk about experts, which is not there in this slide, which is the concept of hot tubbing. Now, hot tubbing is a concept which has come from Australia. It's a kind of a trial where all, see, defendant gets a scientific, he pays him a money, he says whatever defendant wants to say. Plaintiff pays the money, he gets an expert, he sings the song of plaintiff. So the court doesn't know whom to believe. Both are scientists, both are expert in their own field. So in hot tubbing, all these experts are made to sit together face to face. And then there are questions which are laid down by, and issues which are laid down by the court, and they are asked questions at the same time. So obviously scientists, there are a few scientific principles where one can't cut another one. So those admitted portions are very nicely, you know, culled out of that, those particular issues. Then you come down to very specific core issues where the court has to take a stand. So it in a way cut down the trial period, it helps in speedy trials. So these are the things which are being used by the courts very regularly. And I'm sure these can be done, these concepts, not only in IP, these can be taken up from the IP and, you know, introduced to other kind of litigations as well, where you need expert advices for sure. In copyright law, the recent development has been in the field of statutory licensing. Now, this is a very important issue. I'm sure everybody is using Saavn, Gaana, and Spotify is the recent development, and we have our playlist, we enjoy the music, and but we never think, you know, these music are works of somebody, and how are these links using it. Now, we have Section 31 of the Copyright Act. The way there used to be broadcast on television of movies and of songs, your Chitrahar and all that. So you always used to take a license from some organization, a committee of copyright, and the money used to trail down to the actual creators. So the words used in Section 31 of copyright say statutory license, which is a license which has to be mandatorily given to a user. If I go to a authority saying that you own all these works, but these works are basically for the public, so I'm here paying it to you, you better give it to me. So statutory license regime came only after amendments of Copyright Act, and it says that statutory license for broadcasting of literary, musical work and sound recording. Now it only said broadcasting. Broadcasting is a wide, very wide term. With the development of the technology, at that time we didn't have you know, music on our phone. So it was only television or maybe, you know, your radio. So then the question was whether internet broadcasting is covered under this kind of statutory licensing. The DIPP, with virtue of an office memorandum, clarified that internet broadcasting is also covered under this. So they tried to cover up the hole and say, okay, go ahead, do your business, don't bother us. But now there is a divided view here. So people do say that the technology will grow. Nowadays we are listening to the music on our phone. Maybe later on there would be some other gadget where we can listen to the music. So we can't keep on clarifying this. You have to consider broadcasting in a very broader term. The broadcasting could be anywhere. Like today, tomorrow I come up with a wallpaper where I can see a movie, right? And Netflix and all, they can broadcast it there through Wi-Fi or whatever. Maybe, you know, innovation can take us anywhere. So, but there are few people who are taking another stand also, that there has to be an amendment in the act, there has to be clarification. DIPP, just by way of an office memorandum, can't change the law, because that's not the way of doing it. This issue is pending before Supreme Court. So this is also something which has to be seen in the field of IP, how it will proceed. Now in the Spotify issue, Spotify when came, they had an agreement with Warner Chappell, but they had a global agreement. For some rhyme or reason, they didn't give them a license for India. But they were all set to come and launch Spotify in India like after 2 days. So the strategy was, we filed a statutory licensing application before the Copyright Board, and apprehending they will sue us for infringement, we filed the caveats. And we paid them upfront. to show our bona fide. That is also very important, to show that how bona fidely you are in need of it, so that the equities can be balanced out by the court. So we paid them some good crores of money and said that you better give us a license. So if you are not giving, then I send them a notice. I'll take it from the copyright board. When they sued us before the Mumbai High Court, we represented and they said, okay, you deposit the money. You are willing to pay. And then we'll see later once the law is settled by Supreme Court of India. So courts always go by balancing the equities, and it is very important to show that a party who goes before the court, they go with clean intent and clean with clean hands. So then I'll quickly cover intermediary liabilities and infringement of IP. Now this is a very hot topic also nowadays. Like, we are all using e-commerce websites, we are using Amazon, Flipkart, and so many websites. And we also, with these elections, there is a lot of hue and cry, you know, why, how can you post these kind of things, and you know, there's nobody listening, this has to be taken down. Now all these intermediaries, Facebook, WhatsApp and all, they are covered under Section 79 of the IT Act, which is a very broad section which gives them an expansive protection to these intermediates, saying that, you know, now there's a portal of Facebook, I upload anything, if it is not acceptable to somebody, they do not do a diligence check, you know, whatever you have posted, whether it is correct or not, they can't do it. It's just a platform where things are being posted. So they have been given that statutory immunity or protection under Section 79. Now this immunity was tested, the constitutional validity of this section was tested in Shreya Singhal case. You would remember there was a very interesting case where somebody wrote something bad about our Honorable Prime Minister, and those people were jailed, and you know, that thing happened. So there was a case filed and saying that Facebook and all cannot just wash off their hands by saying that whatever you are posting is not in my hand, I do not check it. So there has to be some due diligence, there has to be some machinery where we can complain, and you know. So the answer to that for them was, we have takedown policies. Like, even if there is Google, today I am a copyright owner, I come up with a book, the contents of that are posted by somebody on Google, so I can approach Google and say, look, these are my copyrights, and this has been done by somebody, so you please take it down. Now there is a statutory limit, within 36 hours or some hours, they have to take it down. So so the intermediary said that you have enough protection, you know, you can't read Section 79 more broad than that. But in this section, they said that if an intermediary is abetting into these kind of acts, then these intermediaries will not have the protection of Section 79 anymore. So you have to show that there was a proactive step on their behalf. So today, an infringer comes with a website and tries and collects all sorts of materials and posts it, and then they are collecting money out of it, right? Or hashtagging and meta-tagging others' portals and making money out of it. It's in a way abetting in the crime. So these kind of websites no longer have the protection of Section 79. So this was clarified in Shreya Singhal. And because of this Shreya Singhal decision, there were few guidelines. They said that you have to publicize your rules. That's why whenever you download any application, there are like pages of terms and conditions, right? Though nobody reads that. So you have to make it clear that what data you'll be taking, what data you'll be using, and there has to be an undertaking that you will not pass it on to the others. Even if you are passing it on to the others, some of the websites require that to be done, but then that has to be specified, that what kind of data you would be using and what kind of data you won't be using. And then you have to disable offending, infringing contents within 36 hours. And no rule mandating active screening and removal of infringing content. This is something which is too much for an intermediary to do. They can't monitor each and everything. So this has been left. A very recent judgment which took the clue from the Supreme Court judgment has been Christian Louboutin versus Nakul Bajaj matter. Herein, the defendants were not given Section 79 protection. This is the first time it has happened. Practically. So they said that if you are actively participating and you have a control over that particular post, you have put it, you are advertising it, you are using the marks of that particular party, you are identifying the promoters, so then these are all positive steps, you are making money out of it, you can't just wash off your hands. And if you can establish that you have not exercised due diligence, you are conspiring, aiding and abetting, then this protection goes away. So in this particular case, there was a party who was actually promoting and selling a counterfeit good on the website. So they said that, you know, there's somebody who has approached me and I have a protection. They said, no, you know it is a counterfeit. You know from where it is coming. You know the source, that it is not from the actual proprietor. You know it's a counterfeit, so you don't have that protection. Similar case was from Mumbai High Court also. This was on some original literary work which was being posted on the website, and you were the party was making money out of it. They were modifying it also. So similar kind of ruling was given in Ferment Education case from Mumbai High Court. So Delhi High Court, Mumbai High Court basically are on the same page. The court's observations in this was the few of the points which a defendant can establish, or even an intermediary should be careful about, is that there should not be, like in the cases where you can not get the protection under 79, is retain control over content uploaded. You can review, you can edit, you can approve, you can reject. Then you provide software to create content, that is also not protected. Then paid users for submitting content on the online portal. Fair use, which is an exception in the Copyright Act, that I'm using it fairly for the purpose of fair use, this kind of protection is not there for these kind of cases. Now comes the damages part, which is show me the money for the management. So the trend has changed a bit. You know, whenever you, I know it's difficult for the legal team to tell that there would be expenditure in protecting your IP, but in return, yeah, you would be saving your goodwill, you would be eroding all your, you know, false competitors, but you will get some money, something I can't guarantee. But now there is a positive move in that step. Damages are being granted. In a Merck Glenmark case, that was the starting when 5 crores damages was granted after trial. So initially, I had not seen that provision. Only in some cases, some punitive damages were being granted. But in this after trial, 5 crores were granted in this matter. It was a patent case. Then damages are definitely divided into compensatory and punitive damages. What we usually used to get was punitive damages. There was a rationale in time versus location matter, wherein there was a small party, a defender, who was infringing the mark. So they said, okay, you have not established a your evidence, you have not laid evidence of for your actual damages, for which I can compensate you. But yeah, in order to you know, punish the defendant so that it can act as a deterrent for other parties, I'll give you nominal punitive damages of 5 lakhs. That was the trend. 5 lakhs, I have seen the limit. But this ratio has been overruled in Hindustan Unilever case very recently because they said that the concept of just giving punitive damages and saying that there is no evidence on compensatory damages, I think we should move ahead out of it. It's been long. So parties are encouraged to actually prove their actual damages, which they want to have a compensation on. We are paying a huge amount of court fee when a suit is filed, right? Because of the Commercial Court Act and enhancement of court fee, like when we evaluate a property to be of worth of 2 crores or more, then obviously you should have some evidence to show that your intellectual property is worth 2 crore. Right? It's like, you know, you have a patent, you have so many licenses. So they are paying you royalties worth this much. If you calculate of 10 years of use by the defendant, if he would have been my licensee, I would have earned this much. So this is the kind of calculation which you need to plead. You should plead, which I would encourage and suggest, and you should lead evidence on it. Nowadays, till now, I have not seen parties leading evidence on these kind of matters. So it is very difficult for the court to actually grant your damages. So as general counsels and as people who are working on with the lawyers, I think this kind of homework is expected to be done and you know, take a benefit out of it. So the concept of Rooks versus Bernard, which was which was in the Time matter, was in a way, it was reduced. I would not say it was set aside. And the castle and the broom factors were taken into consideration, that you can't just, you know, give some token damages. The jury has to be satisfied that actually what the plaintiff is suffering, and you have to give damages according to that. Using this in Wattman International case recently in Delhi High Court, 1 crore was granted to the plaintiff as the damages, and the defendant was asked to pay because they were, and there was a finding in this that this party is a serial infringer. So the court used this opportunity to give something to the plaintiff. Now, this data protection and GDPR, I would just take a minute, and I would suggest my colleague Anusuya to take you through this, because this is also something which is very, I spoke on this last year also. We are coming up with data protection rules very soon, and we have an apprehension it would be very close to GDPR. And we as companies who are also having clients in Europe, and you know, maybe some subsidiaries or companies in Europe, our principals are in Europe. So GDPR compliance has been a nightmare. So we'll just have a clarity for 2 minutes from Anusuya.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
I just
want to
say,
this is
very nice presentation.
I'll come back after this. After this portion, I'll come back and sing. Yeah. Yeah, tell me. No, that's kind of, that's one-time use is something which is covered under fair use. Okay. Like if I'm hosting a party at my place and I'm running music on my system, I'm not commercializing that music, right? So I don't need a license. But if, yeah, even for a company, you are doing a get-together kind of a thing, right? Yes, it's for employees. You are not required. But in case I'm organizing some event, like, you know, and where I have clients who, they are coming, they are paying for it. I run a restaurant business, for instance, and I organize an event on New Year Eve, right? I would be playing music on that day. For that, I would need a license because I'll be publicizing that on my tickets. Yeah. It's not commercial. No, it is not commercial. It is not counted as commercial. It is fair use. Yeah?
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll just quickly take you through GDPR and the IP aspects of how GDPR is likely to affect us or might affect us in the times to come. Now, of course, we all know GDPR. It's this very, very vast kind of document that has taken the world by storm because it affects not only EU, but every piece of data that comes into or comes out of or goes into the EU, all their personal information we are now expected to honor and protect. It is, like I said, a very, very widely worded document. What effect it will have is something we are yet to see. The global impact is enormous. It's probably, it's a long arm, longer than any other long arm we've seen before. Again, like a lot of other, you know, IP-related aspects, there's a lot of element of fines and the threat or the deterrence that GDPR is really expected to kind of bring in with it. How far is India reached when it comes to GDPR? Some companies are doing very well on the GDPR index. Some are just about waking up to it. It's a process that even the EU itself yet is not as sure about as they would like to be. Germany is taking a very strict view. Netherlands is saying it's okay, just, you know, deal with things as they come. How does that affect India is something that it's probably too soon to say. We've still seen 2 or 3 years of GDPR, but there's still not enough clarity. Do we need to be compliant? Yes, yes. Are we complying? Not as much as we should, but hopefully in a year or two, maybe when we meet next year, there will probably be developments on this front as well. Who is most affected by GDPR? Anyone who's online, anyone who's working in data, the Facebooks and the Googles of the world, anyone who's transferring data to the EU or anyone who's sending it back out. Essentially, that means all of us will be affected, are affected, and therefore we should be very, very careful about dealing with GDPR. Now, GDPR also comes with the new law that California is about to enact. They said it'll be sometime in 2020. Which will also be as wide and as expansive. Now, we'll have to wait to see whether it conflicts with GDPR at some level or whether they're all on the same page. What is India doing in terms of the courts? Yes, now right to privacy is something that we know is a fundamental right. Will it extend to the right of protection of personal data? How will that really happen? Is something that the Justice Sri Krishna Committee in its draft rules might be able to give us some idea. I will not delve too much on this. There's another session going on the data protection bill, so I don't want to kind of cause an overlap. In terms of cases that have come up in the GDPR, there's this one very interesting study on Tinder. So this French journalist, she asked Tinder, she said, you know, now that I have rights to protection of my personal data through GDPR, I want to know exactly all the data that Tinder has of me. Now, because of GDPR, Tinder was obliged to give her all that data. She didn't stop there. She says, I also want to know how you code your softwares. I want to know how your systems work so that how is it that you give me the kind of links you give me so that I can swipe left or right. That's where Tinder had to stop her. They said, listen, now you're coming into our proprietary domain. This is our patented technology. We can't tell you that. Now, this matter didn't go to court, so we don't know how courts would respond. But these are the kind of issues that GDPR is throwing up. Another issue is, you know, as far as IP owners are concerned, because the policy itself, the GDPR, is so consumer-centric or, you know, person-centric that certain sections of IP owners are feeling that they're incredibly threatened by how this works. So till we have clarity, till there is a balance that either GDPR itself or the Californian law that's going to come in or our data protection bill is able to bring in, there is a state of flux at this point, and it's just something that we'll have to go on with and see where the law takes us. It never reached court, so I think they kind of did what they did on the side, but it never reached court, no. So I'll hand over back to Utkam. Thank you.
This entire GDPR issue is important from the perspective of a consumer, definitely, and also from the perspective of people who are using the data, who are the data users and whose business run on it, because a very important case was there when, you know, you would have seen WhatsApp was taken over by Facebook. Then there was a little change on the look of the WhatsApp also. And in their policies, they said that they would be transferring all the data they have to Facebook. So then this matter went to Supreme Court. There was a petition filed saying that you can't simply transfer my data, which I have uploaded on WhatsApp, to Facebook. Now, because there are practical difficulties to it. If you notice, like when I look at the Loom website and I look at few dresses that, you know, okay, maybe I can buy these. It's an e-commerce website. And then I switch on to NDTV. When I switch on to NDTV website, I see the entire same advert with of that the Loom and the dresses which I had, you know, chosen and seen through. So you test it one day, you will see that, you know, it is always there. So in a way, there is exchange of data by these portals. Now, how much, whatever you go through, like on your website, how much is to be shared, how much is not to be shared is something which is little complicated. Now, IP licensing and related issues, this is important basically on the field of, we are doing a lot of, nowadays you would hear a lot of licensing issues being done, especially in the cases of standard essential patents. Like if you are using a mobile phone, that mobile phone will have lots of apps and lot of features. It has this megapixel camera, that megapixel camera technology could be patented technology of somebody else. Now, when you're especially talking about 2G, 3G, 4G, and now 5G. Now, if somebody has come up with a 3G technology, and if it is being used on the phone, that technology is patented, and nobody else has that technology, it has been approved by a standard, that is a standard essential patent. The moment I come up with a 3G compliant phone, it is presumed and it is known and it is taken that, you know, I am using the technology, 3G patented technology of Ericsson, right? So then I need to take a license from Ericsson. So these are standard essential patents, which has essentiality attached to it. I can't promote that particular device until unless I have that technology. So now in that case, what is to be done? That's why I said that IP is the marketing donut nowadays. Ericsson had launched phones. They used to manufacture phones earlier. Now you won't see even a single phone of Ericsson, but it's a multi-billion company. It's only running on the basis of its portfolio of thousands of patents. These are essential patents. The moment that patent is being used on any device, that they have to take a license. So the courts tell them to deposit money. So licensing is the way forward. When you talk about pharmaceuticals also, in all the pharmaceutical, like all the MNCs, they have patents. Like if India needs that kind of a drug, then we need to take a license from them. And I think licensing is one way, which is the future of IP. It enables the IP owner to, you know, get some money out of it, cover their R&D expenditure, and it also increases the reach. It's in the public interest also. That's why you would see compulsory licensing regime also, statutory licensing regime also. So you can't just create an IP and sit over it. It has to be used by the public, which is in favor of, I think, both. So when you are into licensing agreements, then obviously you have to negotiate well. You would want the maximum royalty to be earned. Then drafting is very important. The licensing has to, whether it is tenure-based licensing, whether you want to renew it, whether it is an exclusive license. Now, exclusive licensing later and without a termination clause, in a way, is a kind of assignment. So are you actually, you know, it's like you are renting a property to a family and they are refusing to vacate that particular premise. It's that kind of a situation. So it should be tenure-based and you can keep on checking and then renewing it. Unambiguously defined clauses should be discouraged. And the classes, the trademarks, the goods, everything has to be clearly worded. Now, licensing of trademark can be with goodwill and without goodwill. That is also something which has to be clearly mentioned in your license agreement. Otherwise, there's a problem in later on. Now, now in the licensing, you have to show that I'm not only just giving a brand or a technology. There are few duties which are to be there on the licensor as well. Like you have a quality check and a control. You can't leave your licensee free. And there has to be reporting and auditing. Then liabilities of infringement. You must keep your enforcement in your hand. If you are a licensor, you have to enforce your brand. So that is also very important. Otherwise, if a party is using it maybe for like 50 years, like that's the case with your, what's that cigarette brand? Godfrey Phillips? Yeah. So for that brand, there was a non-terminable license. So now licensee is in a way, So that has to be there. And the licensor is sitting in US, not doing anything. There's no quality check. There's no control. Then there's no action which is being taken. So in a way, it's an assignment, a transfer instead of a license. So eventually, after like 100 years of use, they can't come back and say, you know, it was my property. Give it back to me. It can't reverse this back. The same was the case with Exide batteries. Exide Technologies was the original coiner of Exide brand in US, but it gave it to Exide India in 1902, and the Indian industry injuncted Exide USA when they came here when the economy was opened in 1991. And we did that case, and it was saying, you know, nothing doing. You gave a license, you didn't do anything of this sort, so you have exhausted your rights. So licensing can be tricky at times. So benefits, definitely you can do the licensing in various manner, merchandising, franchising, co-branding, these are the things. Licensing of patents, I've briefly covered on standard essential patents, and even non-essential patents like pharma patents can be licensed. Recent development drug regulatory regime, we would say that, you know, there has been a ban on a lot of FTC drugs, fixed dose combinations. You would have read in newspapers. That was basically on the basis of public interest, saying that, in drug industry, what happens is there is a patented drug, for instance, of crocin. I will add another facet of it, of maybe ibuprofen into it and make a fixed dose combination. Now, and start selling it. So the court said that there has to be mindful approval by the drug controller of it. It can't be just, you know, you add anything. Yeah, I'm just running it through. So I will circulate this presentation to them. So the court said that there has to be a reason that, you know, addition of something to some patented thing or non-patented thing, you should increase the efficacy. It can't be just, you know, mindless, just to add one more product into your thing. Now, there have been amendments in patents and trademarks rules. Basically, expedited examinations are there. These are for the prosecutions. Startups are being given a lot of push. So there is reduced fee. They are encouraging e-filing. There's a reduced fee if you do e-filing, and you can actually opt for expedited examination for patents if you follow this. Trademarks rules, again, they have constrained. There were 74 forms. Now they have made it more consolidated. There are just 8 forms. Startups, again, reduced fee. And you can do your hearings through video conferencing. So these are all positive steps, all arising out from your initial IP policy, which I said. So basically, when I say, when I said that, you know, these were the targets, I think we are somewhere in middle. We have covered a lot. On enforcement front, we have covered a lot. On damages front, we have covered a lot. By view of commercial courts, we have covered a lot of time gap. And with these rules, definitely, we have covered a lot. So here I would like to end. And in case you have any questions, I would be happy to answer. If you are, you know, if you are the broadcaster, you own the social media, then basically Section 79 is something which is there. You have to be careful. You can take advantage of it, but due diligence has to be there. First thing, whenever you come up with your social media, the terms and conditions have to be very clear. You must have, all the subscribers must, you know, there has to be a machinery that you can't subscribe until unless you sign to the terms and conditions. It protects you in a way. And transfer of data from one portal to another portal, in case the takedown policy in that respect becomes very important, and it has to be expressly specified in your terms and conditions that you have this policy. And sticking by it is very important. If you don't take it down, then, you know, courts can actually come very heavily on it that, you know, there was a complaint, you didn't take it down, and so there could be injunction against you. And there would be an order of overnight pulling it down of that particular data also. Same thing happened in Patanjali case very recently. There was a book of Baba Ramdev which was banned, but there were some blogs which were being put on Facebook, Twitter, and all these websites. So these were dragged to the court saying that you didn't take them down. So I'm giving you an injunction of globally taking it down. Now that's an issue whether court can direct them to do it only in India or globally is something which is pending, but takedown is very important. So your terms and conditions and your compliance to your terms and condition in terms of takedown is very important. So nowadays, that has to, you have to be very careful, because that blanket protection under 79 is no longer there. So the moment a party approaches you saying that, you know, this is something hurting me, that has to be taken seriously. You know, earlier Amazon and all never used to take it seriously, but nowadays they have to take it seriously. Otherwise, you will be attracting court orders against you. Any other question? So, I'm okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.